And welcome to the 2022 State of the Valley presentation presented by the Sonoma Valley Chamber of Commerce. I'm Chamber of Commerce CEO Mark Bodenhammer, and I want to thank you all for tuning in tonight or whenever you take the time to watch this presentation, which is chock full of important information from our elected officials who do so much for our community. First of all, I want to thank all of you, the audience, for participating. I also want to thank all of our speakers. We're very pleased to be joined by Sonoma Mayor Jack Ding, Sonoma County Supervisor Susan Gorin, California State Senator Bill Dodd, and U.S. Congressman Mike Thompson. We'll hear from each of them in just a couple of moments after we have a few quick announcements. First of all, I would also like to thank some outgoing elected officials. This year, we're saying goodbye to Council Members Madeline Agramonte, Kelso Barnett, and Bob Felder, who have all served on the Sonoma City Council and contributed greatly to our community, so we thank them for their service. I also want to thank California Assemblyman Mark Levine, who has participated in many chamber events and who is no longer serving in the State Assembly and whose district is actually shifting a little bit to the west. So I would also like to welcome Assemblymember Cecilia Aguiar-Curry, whose fourth district now covers almost the entirety of Sonoma Valley, and we're very much looking forward to working with her. Finally, pending the final certifications from the County Elections Office, we want to welcome who seem to be the next council members for the City of Sonoma, Patricia Farrar-Rivas, John Gurney, and Ron Wellander. Congratulations. And congratulations to all five candidates who ran a spirited campaign for the Sonoma City Council. It really is, over the past couple of years, with the challenges we've faced, we've learned one thing more than anything else. We all are one big community, and we all rely on each other. Our city, our county, our state, our federal government, the people, our local economy. We are one big team, and we can't do it without each other. So thank all of you for all the work that you do for our communities. I want to also thank the Chamber of Commerce's sponsors. We can't do this without our 400 members or these organizations that pitch in extra to make sure that we can operate the Chamber of Commerce and serve our community without charging an arm and a leg for every service that local businesses need in this very difficult time. So a special thank you goes out to our platinum sponsors, Exchange Bank, Edward Jones, and Sonoma Raceway, our gold sponsors, Redwood Credit Union, Sonoma Index Tribune, and Galata Law Group, and our small business supporters, Whole Foods, Sonoma, Sweet Scoops, North Bay Credit Union, Danielle's Classic Auto Body, Bank of Marin, and Sonoma Market. And finally, we want to thank the City of Sonoma and the County of Sonoma, our economic development partners. Last thing I'd like to mention, I want to thank the community for your support of all of our local businesses. These businesses are strong and creative and resilient, and we've seen all of that over the past few years, but we can't do it without the support of the people of Sonoma Valley, who time after time, in the time of need, step up to support our small, independent local businesses. So thank you to everybody who went out and shopped small on Small Business Saturday. And finally, a reminder that we have Giving Tuesday coming up tomorrow. It's an important day for many local nonprofit organizations. So whether that's the Sonoma Valley Mentoring Alliance, the Ecology Center, La Luz, or our local fabulous community radio station, KSBY, that is our partner in broadcasting this event, please consider supporting these great local organizations. KSBY is actually starting their annual fundraising drive. It's called the Live and Local End of Year Fundraiser, and it kicks off tomorrow on Giving Tuesday. You can go to ksvy.org and click on the Giving tab to learn more about this important fundraising drive. With that, I want to once again thank all of our speakers for being here tonight. We're going to hear about the successes from 2020, which we want to pause to celebrate at the end of the year. We want to hear about some of the challenges. We don't want to sugarcoat everything. There are still issues that we're working through, and we want to hear about each of these elected officials' priorities for the upcoming year. So we're going to start off with Sonoma's own Mayor Jack Ding in just a moment. Jack is a small business owner and a tax expert. He is a longtime local volunteer who's spent many hours working for La Luz, the Sister Cities Organization, and the Sonoma Valley Citizens Advisory Commission. He is a board member of Sonoma Overnight Support, another fabulous local nonprofit organization, and KSBY, our broadcasting partner tonight. In 2020, Jack was elected as a Sonoma City Council member and was selected to serve as mayor for 2022. Mayor Ding is a first-generation immigrant and the first Asian American to serve as mayor of the city of Sonoma. We're very proud to work with him, and we can't thank him enough for joining us tonight. So without further ado, I'd like to introduce our mayor, Jack Ding. And we need Jack to be there we go.
All right.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Welcome and a thank you to Sonoma Valley Chamber of the Commerce for putting everything together for this forum. It has been my honor to serve the city as a mayor this in the past year. The year of 2022 is a very special year. I would like to start my presentation with the PowerPoint. After 2 years of the managing and responding to COVID-19 pandemic, we are pleased to have the return to the normal operations and staffing levels at the city. It is remarkable that we started the year with the biggest surge of COVID-19 cases we had ever experienced. And just 10 days ago, the plaza hosted largest lighting event we can recall. Our community has seen a dramatic recovery to pre-pandemic services and activities. We also saw recovery and rebound in fiscal year 22-23 budget. The financial and the health of our city is driven by the health of our local economy. Transient occupancy tax, hotel tax, is at 25% of our general fund revenue. Sales tax, 26%, includes Sonoma's voter approved half percent of sales tax, which is critical source of our revenue. This is one of the funds, our services to be community. Just under 50% of our expenditures are dedicated to public safety. Here, I would like to highlight some of our budget and performance. First, we have added a deputy for community-oriented policing and problem solving. Also, we have the setup and restoration of the funding to the core recreation partners at a pre-pandemic levels, increased code enforcement for the special events and the high traffic weekends. Funding of the scholarship for youth and senior swimming programs, and the increase of approximately $200,000 to the housing trust fund, and $240,000 for the capital improvement programs. And we have many achievements, and also I would like to share with everyone. This year, we have formed two new commissions. First is the Parks and the Recreation and the Open Space Commission and Climate and Action Commission. Second, also we added non-voting youth member for each city in the commission. We want to hear our young generation's voice and also the Internet Vision as well. Also, I'm very proud to introduce everyone. I host a joint press conference with the Consul General of the Ukraine, just in the front of our city hall. We address our strong support to Ukraine and support our sister city, Kharkiv. We also help the sister city raise the money, more than $100,000 as of the last week. When we do these things for our sister city people, we fully understand we also promote our value, help the people who are in struggling, fighting for freedom, opportunity, and the democracy. We are not a small town, but we're sure we can play an important role on the international stage as well. Next, our housing amendments processing has been moved forward very smoothly. Made municipal code amendments submitted in the sixth cycle in the housing element, increased affordable housing requirements, and adopt multiple family objective design standards. We also completed Friner Creek Bridge, pedestrian bridge project, and on and on. Next, I want to share with everyone on the projects and initiatives in progress. First, we are looking for a new permanent city manager. And also we hired homelessness consultant to coordinate homeless services within the city and valley and the county and the whole area. We want to make full use of our local resources, help the people in need. Cemetery studies, downtown parking management plan, cloud base, electronic plan review system for the beauty, Montini Preserve, overlook connector in the trail, pedestrian crossing improvements on the Broadway. These are among of our projects and initiatives. We are also very fortunate to have an active and engaged community. We were too pleased to bring back our community, recognition, traditions, and financial support for our community partners in the fall this year. For the recognitions, we have our colleague, Steve DePage, treasure artist, Pat Mile Johnson, student and artist, Rue Roddy. Also, we recognize our Olympic medalist, Nikita Ducros, sustainable business honoree, Refill Madness Sonoma. Also, we have to celebrate Sonoma honorees. They are Robert Pomeli, Julie Morrison, Diane Roger Roten, Molly Kyle, Mary and Paul Favaro. We have also returned back to our own traditions. For example, July 4th parade celebration, fireworks display, and jacuzzi car race, and Tuesday night market lighting of the Sonoma Plaza, and more holiday programs to come this month. Here, I want to appreciate our partnership with the Sonoma Chamber of Commerce, visitor bureaus, and community center, and other nonprofit organizations. Sonoma will likely face challenges in the coming year related to inflation, cost of the living, housing insecurity, homelessness, and the drought. These are the challenges are not unique to the Sonoma. There are no quick and easy solutions. The city remains vigilant and open to working to address these complex issues. We are grateful for the ongoing support of our strong and resilient community. There are a lot of the goals and priorities for the coming year. But first order of the business will be seat out of the three newly elected city council members, which will then happen after the election is certified, either December 7th or December 14th. And then we'll continue to complete the city manager and the recruitment process. On behalf of the city council, our interim city manager, and the 42 the city staff members, I thank you for your time and I look forward to continue to serve the city in the 2023.
Wonderful. Mayor Ding, thank you so much. Thank you for your presentation. Thank you for all your efforts. It's been an honor working with you all year, and we appreciate everything that you've done. And we look forward to working. You're not leaving yet, just no longer mayor, presumably after December, but we'll continue working with you in the year ahead, and we look forward to that. So thank you again. Up next, I'd like to introduce our county supervisor, Susan Gorin. Supervisor Gorin was first elected to the board in 2012 and was reelected in 2016 and 2020. She represents the board on numerous local and regional boards and committees, including Zero Waste Sonoma, Petaluma Groundwater Sustainability Agency, the Bay Conservation and Development Commission, and the San Francisco Bay Restoration Authority. She serves as chair of the Sonoma Valley Groundwater Sustainability Agency. She's an advocate for climate adaptation, water conservation, parks and open spaces, bicycle and pedestrian issues, and fire recovery. Longtime Oakmont resident who recently moved back, yay, into her rebuilt home that was lost in the 2017 fires. Congratulations and welcome home. Thank you so much for your service. We look forward to working with you in 2023 and very excited to hear about our county update. Take it away, Supervisor Susan Gorin.
Thank you, Mark, and the entire chamber for this opportunity. What a great get-together, an opportunity to review the state of the Valley. And thank you, Mayor Ding, for your incredible service. Over the past year, I've loved working with you, and I still will work with you on the Sonoma Valley Groundwater Sustainability Agency. Lots to do. We are in drought, absolutely. And I think you set the stage for a discussion about what's really amazing about Sonoma Valley, and that's the incredible collaboration that we have seen over the past number of years, of course, with the 2017 fires, the horrific fires, five fires since then, and the COVID pandemic that we weathered through together. We are so delighted that we are able to have community events together, although we're still on Zoom for this, which is great. And I love to use Zoom for the wonderful communication device that it has become. It is really important to talk about changing faces. You talked about some changing faces at the city of Sonoma, certainly a new council, congratulations. soon a new city manager, a new planning director, and in the same vein, a new CAO, County Administrative Officer, for the County of Sonoma. Most people don't know Cheryl Bratton. She's the glue that holds the board and our various departments and the cities together. She, when we appointed her, she was out of the County Council's office, and boy, I thought this was going to be really challenging. And she immediately confronted the 2017 fires. And since then, rolled with the punches every step of the way, organizing us and ensuring the great collaborations that we have with the cities, county, all the various county departments, state and federal elected officials and governments, to make sure that we have the services and the funding we need to weather the storm. And it is really important to recognize Congressman Thompson and Senator Dodd for the contributions that they made for all of that, all of the funding, all of the infrastructure dollars, all of the ARPA dollars, and all that we have enjoyed over the years through the rental relief and many, many other programs desperately needed. We are in the final stages of hiring for that position, and we hope to announce our new CAO by mid-December. And you know, we have a strong pool of candidates, so we will be in good hands. One of the brilliant things that we have discovered is how important collaborations have been over the past couple of years and will continue to be. We are, the county and the city are engaged in conversations regarding shared services. What does that look like? Can we provide services more effectively and efficiently by pooling our resources, cities, county, schools, and certainly aided by the Catalyst Fund, all working together? So wait, we will be engaging in that conversation next year. And we hope to talk to you about what does shared housing, homeless services, law enforcement, planning services, recreation and parks, infrastructure. The opportunities are endless, and I'm anxious to begin those conversations with you, certainly with our business community and our community. Let's talk briefly about infrastructure. What we have sat in traffic far too long on Highway 37, and really need to thank Senator Dodd for his support and Congressman Thompson for his support on planning for the interim as well as the ultimate projects across Highway 37. We thought we were going to have to abandon that critical linkage because of rising tides, and yet here we are, four counties working together on solutions for the future. I can't say that it's going to happen quickly, but I will say that it will happen. Also, further up the valley, we know that the final construction drawings and designs are being planned for the intersection of 116, 121. Again, thank you, Senator Dodd, for your support in encouraging Caltrans to fund that critical linkage. Hopefully it will speed the traffic coming down from Sonoma Valley and Napa Valley to Highway 37. Further up that, we're beginning the planning for the traffic circle at 8th Street East and Fremont Drive. And we have an earmark from Congressman Thompson to begin that process. Thank you so much. Really, really important. Somehow that planning fell off the shop plan about a decade ago, but we've reactivated it. You may have noticed that we're going to have many bridges replaced in Sonoma Valley. Boys, a Boulevard Bridge was just completed. Watna Bridge is about ready to begin reconstruction in 2024. Caltrans is replacing two bridges along Highway 12. It is not easy. It will inconvenience so many of us. It is absolutely essential that we replace those old bridges. Let's talk about housing. Oh man, our housing element is moving forward just as the housing element of the city of Sonoma. And the regional housing needs assessment has assigned about 2,800 units for unincorporated Sonoma Valley. We don't know where they will go yet. The housing element is moving forward, and we'll have a joint meeting of the two municipal advisory councils and the CAC on Wednesday evening. So you might pay attention. But the first opportunity for additional housing has to be at the Sonoma Developmental Center. Long, long process. And thank you, Senator Dodd and Senator McGuire and Assemblymember Aguirre Curry for having faith in our community to plan for that incredible facility at Sonoma Developmental Center. I'm not sure how many housing units we can squeeze on there, but opportunities abound for education, certainly maybe a climate center there, educational opportunities, workforce development opportunities, services, and of course, housing. So stay tuned on that one. That comes to the board on December 16th as the final stage. Maybe, we'll see. The spring specific plan is coming forward next year, long awaited, another opportunity for housing. Vacation rentals, continuing saga, the next 10 years of my efforts on trying to make sense out of vacation rentals will be having its final, hopefully final, hoorah in the next month or two. Let's talk about parks. I'm so pleased that we were able to get an earmark from Senate, from Assemblymember Levine to start the collaboration for the first phase of Maxwell Farms Regional Park. And we hope to begin the renovations for Larson Park very soon while we plan for the second phase of Maxwell Park. But we celebrate the opening of other regional parks with Calabasas, Mark West Creek, and a number of other parks coming forward. And we hope to add to the Jack London Park and the Sonoma Valley Regional Park with the legislation sponsored by Senator Dodd, adding that land, 700 acres to those two parks. What a joy it is and will be to continue to live in Sonoma Valley. So I know my time is running short, but what is coming forward is a new planning for a new county center at the site of the existing administration center. But along with that, we are negotiating for a front door in Sonoma Valley for the county services to be provided to the valley. This is an incredible step in the right direction. There is more than we can talk about, but thank you all for coming together to plan for a more resilient future with the planning that we have collaboratively conducted regarding fires, pandemic, vegetation management, and all of the other assets and emergencies that we can possibly think of. Oh, I'm not gonna say the earthquake word. There is a fault that runs up Sonoma Valley. So no fires and no earthquake, but we are prepared for it nevertheless. Thank you all. It's been an honor to serve all of you. And I look forward to continue our great conversations for a bright and prosperous new year. Thank you.
Wonderful. Thank you, Supervisor Gorin. And it's great knowing ahead of time that there will be no fires, earthquakes, or other major disasters ever in 2023. Good indeed to know. Thank you. I appreciate working with you as well. And thanks for your service for our community. And that's great news. We'll have a county services public-facing agency here in the Valley. Up next, very pleased to welcome our fabulous State Senator Bill Dodd. Senator Dodd represents California's 3rd Senate District, which covers all of Napa and Solano counties, as well as portions of Contra Costa, Sacramento, Yolo, and his favorite county, of course, Sonoma County. He is chair of the Senate Governmental Organization Committee and is a member of the Transportation Committee, the Energy, Utilities, and Communications Committee, and the Insurance Committee. His work has spanned many topics from public education and environmental to data privacy and protecting seniors. During his tenure, he has established himself as the most prolific lawmaker in the legislature, authoring 99 bills, including SB 846. And if you like getting adult beverages to go from your favorite local Sonoma Valley restaurants, you can thank Senator Dodd for that. He and his wife, Mary, live in Napa and have 5 grown children and 12 grandchildren. Boy, you're going to have a busy month here coming up. We always love working with him. Now I'm pleased to introduce California State Senator Bill Dodd. Bill, it's not April of 2022 or April of 2020. You should know to unmute by now. Let's go. Hang on.
How embarrassing.
There we go. All right. You're rocking and rolling now. One more time. Please welcome State Senator Bill Dodd.
Yay. All right, Mark, thank you very much. I really appreciate the Sonoma Valley Chamber of Commerce for inviting me to speak tonight. I'd like tonight, first of all, I'd like to thank Mayor Ding and Supervisor Gorin for their great updates. And it's helpful for me to know all what's going on in our city and our county. Tonight, I'd like to share some updates on addressing wildfire prevention and response, the state's action to ensure that we have reliable and affordable electrical grid, and share a legislative update from Sacramento and what we might expect next year. The last few years have had major challenges and uncertainty, especially among business owners like yourselves. We've learned to live with COVID and avoid its worst impacts. Compared to the week after Thanksgiving 2021, we're certainly in a much better place. We've continued our work with ongoing problems, from wildfires to homelessness to drought. And we've also faced new challenges with a looming recession and higher tensions at home and abroad. But Californians are resilient, and we still lead the nation in so many ways. We marked just 5 years since the Tubbs and Nuns fire that devastated our region, and 2 years since the Glass and Hennessy fires. And when you are rebuilding after a fire, those years go by fast. And I'm grateful that we avoided another year of major fires in the Sonoma Valley, but wildfire is something that we will continue to learn to live with and be ever vigilant of. We are investing in CAL FIRE's capacity to have a strong initial attack on small fires quickly so they don't become mega fires. California's inventory of air and rotorcraft is significantly increasing and will be strategically placed throughout the state. We've recently seen several prescribed fire projects right here in the Valley, funded by a state budget allocation I recommended. Those controlled burns make us all safer and the natural environment more healthy. And I've also authored bills this last year to improve defensible space programs and to make prescribed fires easier to do. And that work continues on. I want to give an update on the electrical grid and my bill to extend the life of Diablo Canyon nuclear plant. You know, it's when you're doing something for a nuclear plant in this state, 50% of the people either love you or hate you. I'll explain a little bit about why I did it. Our electrical grid is much like the plumbing in all our homes. As long as it's working, we don't pay much attention to it. But this year we had several days in the summer heat where we almost had rolling brownouts to keep up with the demand. Although we avoided brownouts, the issue of high electrical demand with limited supply will continue to exacerbate as we see more intense heat waves. Nuclear power in the state still plays an integral role in our power grid. And with a growing state that also has very aggressive climate goals, we can't afford to lose nuclear power from the equation. 10% of our state's power and 20% of our green energy is nuclear as we are here this evening. Business owners can feel the economy is slowing, and it's possible, I hope not, but it's possible a recession is coming. But maybe Susan said no recession either. I would be for that, Susan. But California is prepared for that. California is once again in a strong financial position due to our thoughtful budgeting, and we must continue to be responsible stewards of our fiscal resources. A year ago, we saw our projected budget surplus was both an opportunity and a responsibility. And frankly, I think we met that challenge. We did it with lasting investments that will have ongoing returns over time. And we structured our budget with one-time spending without any new ongoing programs that would just be cut when revenues declined. And first, we made sure we maxed out our rainy day fund with over $37 billion in reserves. And this is a record for the state of California. And I think a clear demonstration of the state's responsible budgeting and planning. We had so much revenue come in, we constitutionally had to give some of it back as a tax refund. Eventually, what came out was a $9.5 billion middle-class tax rebate that will go to the vast majority of middle-class and working people in our state. This budget provides a record investment of over $47 billion for infrastructure projects that create jobs and to prepare us for the future economy. That is including almost $15 billion for transportation and billions more for school facilities, housing projects, libraries, dam safety, and more. One-time investments like those are some of the best ways to spend a surplus, in my view. In an effort to support small business in this budget, it contained over $2 billion to help with payroll taxes, the diesel tax, and drought relief. And I hope we can do more next year. During my 8 years as a legislator, one of my biggest concerns is how we are funding our public schools. But we're making real progress now. Putting money in the classroom was a priority for us with a 13% increase in ongoing funding to California schools, with plenty in reserve to alleviate local school districts' fear over budgetary volatility. Now, as California enters another year of drought, we all feel the various impacts associated with climate change. We are spending $19 billion in climate energy package. Much of that money can be spent locally on a more robust electric vehicle charging network, increasing transit and bike options, and protecting our natural lands. Understand that by building better housing, creates stronger communities, California will spend $2 billion on affordable housing and an additional $2 billion in student housing. Santa Rosa Junior College is close to completing its first student housing building in decades. Homelessness continues to be a growing issue, but we've seen some progress. Through Project Home Key, we have built or refurbished thousands of transitional housing units for people who need shelter. We also launched the Care Corps, which is a new legal approach to providing care and treatment to those most in need on our streets. Ignoring the problem or shifting it to someone else is not the solution we need. The next 2 years in the legislature will be my last 2 years. I'm looking forward to working on issues that have long-term positive impact on our district and state. I want to hear all your ideas, so please call my office. We know that California has big, big challenges, but with careful planning, we're ready for what happens next year, and we'll continue to lead the nation. Before I close, I'd like to thank our mayor and supervisor and Congressman Mike Thompson for being a partner with me to help Sonoma County. They're always there, ready to do some heavy lifting. And thanks to the chamber, and thank you everybody, and happy holidays.
Senator Dodd, thank you so much. Thanks for all of your work. It's great knowing that you're up there representing our community in Sacramento, doing great things up there. So really appreciate it. Up next, pleased to introduce our Congressman Mike Thompson. Congressman Thompson represents California's 5th Congressional District, which includes all of Napa, parts of Contra Costa, Lake Solano, and right here in Sonoma County. First elected to Congress in 1998. Prior to serving in Congress, he was a representative of California's 2nd Senate District, where he chaired the powerful Budget Committee. He's a member of the House Committee on Ways and Means, serves as chairman of the Select Revenue Measures Subcommittee, and a senior member of the Health Subcommittee. He's co-founder and co-chair of the Bipartisan Wine Caucus. He's part of the Sportsman Caucus. Also a Vietnam veteran, and his number one priority is creating jobs and to grow our economy. He and his wife, Janet, live in St. Helena, 2 sons, one a firefighter, one is a deputy sheriff, and 3 wonderful granddaughters. And we are very proud and pleased to work with Congressman Mike Thompson. And now for an update on the federal government, we turn it over to our Congressman.
Well, Mark, thank you very much for inviting me. And my thanks to the Sonoma Valley Chamber of Commerce. You guys have been great, and you are in large part responsible why it is such a great spot in the Valley. And you've got a great team, and you all work very well together. And speaking of teams, I want to thank my colleagues who are on this Zoom, Jack and Susan and Bill. You know, it doesn't work unless you have good people who are devoted to the constituents that they serve and willing to work together. And I'm really proud of the way that we all pitch in, we all work well together. And I'm proud to be part of that team. And Bill and I do it in 5 different counties. It's just a great group to work with. Congress has been pretty busy this last year and a half, 2 years. And as mentioned by both Jack, Susan, and Bill, the American Rescue Plan, I think, is a prime example of that. It was that effort led by Congress that allowed us to respond to COVID. That American Rescue Plan provided funds to state and local governments that allowed our state and local partners to be able to do the great things that you heard about today. It also provided an incredible response to the virus itself. The vaccine effort that was put forth is never has anything like this been seen anywhere in the world. We were able to help small businesses. We were able to help employees stay employed. We were able to provide funding for schools so we could get kids back in schools. And as I said, get shots in arms and keep things going during a real rough period. And the COVID's no fun. I had it last week. I got, and I can tell you, it not only is it the illness bad, but I got stuck in Washington for 5 days by myself, and it was not a fun quarantine. We also passed the bipartisan infrastructure bill that I think all 3 of my colleagues have mentioned how important transportation projects are. And this infrastructure bill does all the things that infrastructure bills have always done. Monies for roads, bridges, highways, and a lot more, including clean drinking water, fire prevention, and an expansion of broadband. California will get at least $100 million to expand broadband, and that's incredibly important. And I just want to take a second to digress a bit. I mentioned in the on the COVID response, one of the things we did is we allowed Medicare recipients to get their Medicare services through telemedicine. And that was a bill of mine that that I've been working on, as you guys know, for quite a while. We put that into law, and Medicare recipients were able to stay home and get their health care rather than to be exposed at a facility. And the truth is, if you don't have connectivity and you're on Medicare, you got worse health care than someone who does. And the same thing happened with kids doing distance learning. If your child or grandchild had connectivity, they got a better educational opportunity than kids that didn't. So the fact that we're going to expand broadband is extremely important. Broadband needs to be in every house and every business. It's good for the reasons I mentioned. It's good for expanding business. It's just the right thing to do. We passed the PAC Act that provides services to veterans who were exposed to toxics in their deployment. This has been a real rough go for veterans and their families, and this will help them a lot. One of the problems that we saw when it surfaced during COVID was the lack of computer chips, and that contributed greatly to the disruption in our supply chain. And we passed the CHIPS Act that will bring chips manufacturing back onshore in the United States. We went from producing 36% of the world's chips to 12%, and 0% of what they call significant computer chips. And since that bill is passed, we've had big investments. Micron invested $15 billion in computer chip manufacturing in the United States. Intel, $20 billion, and Wolf Speed, $5 billion already. So it's going to make a real difference. And then we passed the Inflation Reduction Act, which is an important piece of legislation for a number of reasons. It caps out-of-pocket expenses that seniors pay for Medicare at $2,000 a year, and provides for the negotiation for the purchase of prescription drugs, something that's going to be very, very important. And it capped the price on insulin at $35. We pay just an almost criminal amount of money for insulin in this country. The average price is over $98 as opposed to other countries that are paying in the teens, $10, $12, $15. And that's just inappropriate. So we took care of the folks that are on Medicare. Hopefully we'll be able to expand that to include everyone. And then we also, in this Inflation Reduction Act, have a provision that moves folks more quickly to renewable energy. And I'm particularly proud of that because it was a bill of mine, the Green Act. And it provides so many opportunities for people to purchase energy efficient appliances and get tax help for that. Electric cars, move to solar and wind power. That's going to be extremely important going forward. And then the one other important bill that we passed, and it's a real sad time right now with another wave of mass shootings. If it seems like there's a mass shooting every day, it's probably because there are. We've had over 600 mass shootings this year, and it's terrible. Gun violence is an epidemic, and as everybody knows, you know, I'm a gun owner. I support the Second Amendment. But, you know, we need to be able to have responsible, sensible laws that protect our communities. And we can do that without violating the Second Amendment, without, you know, taking people's guns that they collect, use for hunting or self-protection. If you're a danger to yourself or others, if you're a criminal, if you're dangerously mentally ill, you shouldn't have a gun. And we should be doing, everybody should be on the same page in trying to get us there. We passed the Safer Communities Act, which did some important things. It closed what's known as the boyfriend loophole, where prior to this, if you were married to someone and you abused your spouse, you were prohibited from owning a gun. But if you weren't in a married relationship, you weren't. And that makes no sense at all. It expands background checks for people under 21 years of age who buy guns. And it closes some loopholes in both the straw purchasing laws, where people who are prohibited from owning guns get somebody who's not to buy a gun for them. It really enhances the penalties for that, and for gun show sellers as well. And importantly, there's funding in here for school security and for more mental health funding, which I think.
Congressman, we lost your audio.
We have another month of this congressional session, and we go back. I leave in the morning to go back, and we've got some important things. We have to pass a funding bill for FY23, and that's important for a number of reasons, including, Susan mentioned, I've got some road improvement money on that bill, along with some Boys and Girls funding for Sonoma County and some homelessness housing funding for Sonoma County. So that's important to get done. We're operating right now on a continuing resolution, which expires on the 16th of December. We need to figure out how to expand that to keep the government funded. There's one school of thought that we need to do it for a year to make sure that with the change in power in the House, we we want to make sure the government stays funded. There's a number of vocal critics in the what will be the new majority who thinks that we shouldn't fund the government, which is a pretty frightening thought. So we're going to be working through that. We still have to pass a defense bill. I've got some priorities that are important to the community. I'm working on legislation to provide mitigation to this for people who've lost their homes in the fires and are part of the PG&E fund. Right now, there's some concern that some of those folks may experience being taxed on the money they get from that fund. And I think that's wrong. And then two, everyone is exposed to a tax problem on the part of the fund that went to lawyers' fees. And you would think that with as many lawyers as they had working on that, they would have figured this out. But sadly, they didn't. And so we're trying to fix that at the federal level. I also have some mental health legislation. I think next to climate change, mental health is the biggest problem that we face as a people today. And I've got a pretty important bill that would help provide mental health services to folks who are on Medicare. And we need to continue. Next year, I'm going to be working on a major mental health legislation that would try and focus the attention on research of the brain to be able to solve the problems before they manifest. And we have to spend funding that we'll never have enough to deal with. And then two, I want to expand our disaster relief for our agricultural community that was hurt in the fires. So we've got a lot of work to do. You mentioned, Mark, that I represent the 5th district. The next time that we meet, I will be representing the 4th district. So our congressional district changes a bit. We lose Contra Costa County and the parts of Solano County that I now represent. And I pick up the parts of Solano County that I don't represent now. And I'll pick up most of Yolo County. And that's a great district. I've represented all those areas before. I think it fits very well with Napa, Sonoma, and Lake County. There's a big agricultural component in that district that will fit well with our district. And so next year, as the representative from the 4th district, I'll be working on, as I said, mental health issues, continue to work on tax policy, gun violence prevention, and most certainly the strong continuation of our democracy. So I look forward to working with all of you, and thanks so much for everything all of you do.
Wonderful. Congressman Thompson, thank you so much. Thanks for your leadership, and thanks for being here and being a part of this today. I want to thank each and every one of you who was a participant today. One of the things, every time we do this event, I'm struck by how much interaction there is between our city, our county, our state, our federal government, and more importantly, how well all of the four of you work together. That's not the case in every community. We're really fortunate to have people who are so dedicated to working together and to doing whatever it takes to represent the people of Sonoma Valley and the other parts of the districts that you guys serve. So we thank you so much for your efforts all year long, both in 2022 and looking forward in the year ahead. And we wish you all a happy and prosperous holiday season. And to all of the viewers, thank you for tuning in. Thank you for participating in the 2022 State of the Valley presentation. Have a great evening and a great holiday season. And we wish everyone all the best in 2023. Thanks for listening.